Hi there. My name is Chuck Cosman, and I'm a launch engineer here at Shopify. Thanks for tuning in today. For more helpful videos to help you build on Shopify, make sure you subscribe to our channel to get notifications when we release a new video. In this tutorial, we're going to be looking at a few features of GraphQL useful for building applications at scale. We've split this tutorial up into separate videos. In this first section, we're going to be looking at operation names and variables as a way to be able to recycle your GraphQL requests at scale. So here I'm using the graphical IDE. This is an app installed on a development store where I have some products, customers, and orders populated. If any of that sounded like crazy jargon, take a look at our Getting Started with GraphQL video in the Shopify Developer Series to get started with the setup. What I have here right now is a pretty simple product query. All I'm doing here is I'm retrieving a product by its ID, and I'm supplying that GraphQL ID to the ID argument here. Now, this will work, so I'll hit play here, and I should get this data back. But this is not really going to be reusable at scale, because I'm going to have to pass this query in literally somewhere when I make an HTTP request. And so that means that if I want to change out the IDs, I'm going to have to compose the query each time using string interpolation. And while that's okay, it's not ideal. And it's not really taking advantage of GraphQL's typing system either. So there's a few things that we can add right at the beginning of the body of this query to make this more reusable. And those are both operation names and variables. Keep in mind this is implicitly a query because I've left out the query keyword. I am going to need this for this next thing though. Now, I can name this operation whatever I want by entering an operation name right after this query keyword. And I could equally well do this for a mutation too. So if this said mutation and then space, I could do this. And kind of convention here is Pascal case and describing what you're getting back. So I'm going to say product, title, and description. I'm going to run this again, and you'll see that nothing actually changes. But I'm free to add this operation name here. The next part of this is variables. And the variable syntax looks like this. I'm going to open parentheses here after the operation name. And I'm going to say that I'm going to supply a variable ID. And the way that I do that is by using the dollar sign to say this is a variable. I'm going to put a colon, and then I'm going to say, and this variable is of type ID. This is the importance of variables here, is that I actually have to specify the type. Now I'm going to change this query slightly to say, I'm going to copy this to my clipboard. And what I'm going to say here is that the ID that I'm supplying to this product field is the ID variable. Now, when I hit play here, I haven't actually supplied a variable. So it's going to say, hey, we were expecting you to supply type ID to this ID variable. You didn't provide a valid value. I actually supplied nothing. This is where this query variables pane comes in use in things like HTTP clients or the graphical app. And the syntax for actually supplying variables looks like this. I'm going to open a set of curly braces, and I'm going to say the ID value. And notice here that it actually picked up that I am trying to supply an ID variable of type ID. It already knows this based on the way that I've set up my query up there. So what I'm going to do here instead is I'm just going to copy and paste that ID that I grabbed before, and I'll run this. And what the IDE is doing in the background is it's substituting this value into the ID variable over here without having to do any string interpolation of my own. The actual feature of the GraphQL language is allowing me to do this. Now, this isn't terribly descriptive here just because we're working in an IDE, but we can see what this looks like in just a really simple client application. So I'm going to flip over to VS Code here in a moment and show you where these might come in handy at scale. Okay, over here, in VS Code, I've built a very simple application using a client library called GraphQL-Request. This is just a very lightweight, bare-bones way of making GraphQL requests using Node. And essentially, these few lines are just to get this application to cooperate in the Node environment rather than a browser environment. And I'm also using .env so that when I actually go to make this request, I'm not in this screencast exposing my private app password to you dear viewer. All that I'm doing here is I've hard-coded the endpoints that I'm making the requests against. This happens to be the address of the test store that I'm using. I'm instantiating this GraphQL client and supplying the requisite headers, namely application JSON, and then the actual password that belongs to my private app. When you work with GraphQL on apps, you'll often see queries defined in this way, where the client that you're working with usually has a tagged template literal function, where you are passing in a string that is your request, whether it's a query or a mutation. And you'll see here I am using the variable syntax. I'm saying that I'm going to supply an ID of type ID, and then I will supply that to the argument ID. Many different uses of ID, but they all serve their own distinct purpose. Next, what I'm doing down here is I'm defining the variables that I'm going to pass in. So just like in that query variables pane of GraphQL, I'm specifying an object of key ID and then the actual string that corresponds to the project ID. I'm actually issuing that request according to the method that's defined in the GraphQL request package, and I'm supplying the query along with the variables that I've defined. I don't have to do my own string interpolation, and then I'm just console logging that result. I'm going to run this script here, and lo and behold, I get back the data that I expect. Now, here's where variables come in handy. I down here have some other variables defined where I'm issuing a different product ID. I'm going to issue that request in exactly the same way. I'm going to say issue the same query, that is this, but supply the other variables that I've defined. So not this product, but this product, and then also console log that. So I'm just going to run that as well. And now I get both. This is the importance of variables, is that I didn't have to do any of my own string interpolation. That's already built into GraphQL. Right now, this query is unnamed. It's not using any operation name. If I comment this out again just to say I'm going to make one request, let's say I were to introduce a syntax error in here. I forgot a curly brace. And I ran this script again after I saved it. It's going to yell at me that, hey, you didn't do this correctly. And what's interesting here is I'm looking directly at the query itself, and without naming this operation, it's really hard for me to go through. Now, this is a very simple application. It's just making one request. You could imagine that at scale, you'd want to see if a request was failing, you'd want to know which request was it. I don't want to have to go through my entire application and figure out where a query of this structure was. I kind of want my logs to be able to figure that out based on an operation name. So again, I can arbitrarily introduce an operation name right here. I'll say product ID and title, let's say, just because that's the information that I'm getting back in this query. And without fixing the syntax error, I'm just going to clear and run this again. I'll just do this. Now when it fails, I at least have the operation name in my logs. And that's where the importance of operation names comes in, is it's really kind of analogous to the difference between an anonymous function and a named function. In anonymous functions, they are functions without names, so it's very difficult in a stack trace to actually ascertain where the error is occurring. That's kind of the recommendation of why you would name functions, is that in a stack trace it says this function of this name is failing. Exactly the same principle here, in that you don't have to name queries or mutations, but it's very useful for the purposes of debugging at scale. Thanks for joining us so far. In the next section of this tutorial, we'll be looking at another feature for working at scale called aliases.